السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله، ومعلمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا أرحم الراحمين. أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى to bless this gathering إن شاء الله. أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى to protect us all from the hellfire. And I ask Allah سبحانه وتعالى to increase us in إيمان إن شاء الله. Just because of the time, as usual, every Thursday we take a hadith and we take the story behind it and we explain it, inshallah, and we get some lessons out of it. Today's hadith, I don't think many people have heard this hadith before, which is, inshallah ta'ala, it's something new to learn, inshallah. So the hadith, عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال إن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إن رجلا ممن كان من قبلكم حمل معه خمرا في سفينة وكان معه قرد، قال فكان الرجل إذا باع الخمر شابه بالماء ثم باعه فأخذ القرد الكيس فصعد به فوق الدقل، قال فجعل يطرح دينارا في البحر ودينارا في السفينة حتى قسمه. So Abu Hurairah رضي الله عنه narrated that رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said that amongst the people before you there used to be a man who carried wine, used to sell alcohol in his ship, and he used to mix the alcohol with water. And this man had a monkey. He had a monkey on the ship with him. Subhanallah, he used to mix the alcohol with water in order to increase the sale, you know. So Rasulullah said, the monkey took the bag of money after the end of the day, the sales, and jumped up the, what do you call it? Well, you have the flag of the boat, the mat, yeah. And then he stood on top of it and he started throwing one dinar in the bahar and one dinar in the ship until he gets rid of all the haram. Subhanallah. How many people heard this hadith before? Exactly, because it was also my first time hearing it. That's why I'm trying to bring you a hadith. Of course, they're all authentic that we could learn from, inshallah ta'ala. One of the main, obviously, or before we discuss the main lesson, somebody, you know, would say, we're worried about the guy cheating and he's selling alcohol. Just like somebody, you know, before somebody scream at him, you didn't say Bismillah before you drink alcohol. No, at that time, keep in mind that alcohol was permitted, just like before Islam. Even in the beginning of the Sharia, alcohol was permitted. Alcohol was not prohibited yet. So that is the case also here. So alcohol was not prohibited at that time. So the man was legally, openly, he was cheating. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال مر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. One time Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم was passing by and a guy was selling some stuff. So he put his hand through the, let's say, some fruits. He put his fingers through them and he felt that it's wet. The bottom or the top. The bottom is wet. The bottom part is wet, drenched. So he said, what is this? يا صاحب الطعام. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم told the man, what is this? You're putting the good stuff on top and the defective on the bottom? قال يا رسول الله أصابته السماء. يعني يا رسول الله, it rained on it. That's why it became very drenched, so I put it in the bottom. قال أفلا جعلته فوق الطعام حتى يراه الناس. You should have put it on top so people know what happened to it. من غشنا ليس منا. Whomsoever deceive us, he's not one of us. Whomsoever deceive us is not one of us. Those two ahadith about cheating. One more. ما من عبد, listen carefully يا أخوان, because this applies to every leader, to every father, to every person in authority, to every person in charge of anyone. ما من عبد يسترعيه الله عز وجل رعية يموت وهو غاش رعيته إلا حرم الله عليه الجنة. الله أكبر. No one has been trusted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to rule or to be in charge of people, of a group of people, and he cheats them, Jannah will become haram on that person. Jannah will become haram on that person. Sometimes, especially if anyone in the business field, we think that it is very shrewd. You know, you got rid of some merchandise that was not selling for a long time because of a defect, not because nothing wrong with it, just out of style or anything. No, there was a defect in it, and you told your friend, we got him, I got rid of it. Wallahi, it will get back to you sooner or later. Sooner or later, you will see that money that you made either spent on the sickness of your child or the sickness of your mother or your wife. You will see that money that you thought, because you were very shrewd, you took it from someone, dhulm. Anytime you think of acting smart to cheat someone, remember, فَوَرَبِّكَ لَنَسْأَلَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ عَمَّا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Allah is saying, by Allah, by myself, I will ask them all of what they used to do. We will be questioned. And keep in mind the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the son of Adam will not move on the day of judgment until he's asked four questions. 50% of the questions is about income. 50% too. Where did you get it from and where did you spend it? Allahu Akbar. I was giving a lecture today to the sisters in Arabic every first Thursday and last Thursday of the month. I give lecture in Arabic. If anybody have their sisters, their wives only understand Arabic, the halaqa is in Arabic. So we passed by hadith, subhanAllah. The hadith of when Rasulullah said, Jibreel came to me and inspired to me and told me that if the rizq is slow, do not seek it through haram. Because whatever is with Allah cannot be gained except with His pleasure. You will never be able to get that with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through ma'asiyah, through disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why I always tell the brothers, when they go to fundraise for a masjid, they want to fundraise to build a house of Allah. And inside they're mixing the men and the women together. They want to disobey Allah by pleasing Allah, by building a house for Him, as if Allah needs their help. This does not happen, does not work. You know, when they ask me, how come you made 1.6, 1.8, 1, 2 million? You think it's me? Astaghfirullah. Wallahi, I have nothing to do with it. I always tell them, you know what? Maybe, Allahu A'lam, we are the only fundraising that has a wall between the brothers and the sisters. There's nothing could be gained. Allah's pleasure could not be gained through disobeying Him. It's never going to happen. Wallahi, someone, a psychiatrist, just called me before I come, talking about cheating. Two brothers are cheating on their wives with two Muslim sisters because of the mixing. He told me, I'm sorry, I couldn't make it. I had an emergency case. Two brothers called me. I was supposed to meet the brother. And then he was late. He said, I got emergency. The wives called me. My husbands are cheating on me. What's the, boil it down. What is it, the bottom line? Mixing. Free mixing. You know what? I will only learn when it happens to me. I will never learn from somebody else. You will not learn until something bad happens. Then we say, you know what? Mixing is not good. Subhanallah. The smart one, the shrewd one, the one who learns from someone else's mistakes. I don't have to wait for something bad to happen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, for the purest woman ever created, the purest woman ever created, the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sah, talking to the purest men after the prophets, the Sahaba. They said, if you want to talk to each other, talk from behind the hijab. ذَلِكَ أَطْهَر أَطْهَر Purer. Huh? To who? To the most pure people. So how about me? سُبْحَانَكَ يَا رَبِّي. So, cheating in all forms is forbidden in Islam. وَمَنْ غَشَّنَا فَلَيْسَ مِنَّا This is big. Big statement from Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. He's not one of us. He's not one of us. And you're out. This is how deep is the sin of cheating. Two brothers. They're Muslim brothers, not blood brothers. There was a masjid. The Sheikh was telling the story. There was a masjid in Syria. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our brothers in Syria and save them from all this grief that they're going through. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. So this, he said that there is a masjid in Syria where most of the people go pray their janazah there. And the janazah go through the market and goes to the masjid. Because over there they carry the janazah on their shoulder. And then they take it to the masjid. So he said there were two brothers that very close. The brother had some financial difficulty. So he asked the brother, he said, I need this amount of money. He said, sure, no problem. But you see that piece of land that you have? You put it in my name, bay' shira, as if you sold it to me. And when you give me back the money, I give you back the land. Anything wrong? He said, no, no problem. Gave him the piece of land, got the money. 5-6 months, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him. He took the money and went back to the brother. Here's your money. Jazakallah khair, barakallah feek. Thank you so much. Let's go back to the city hall and register the land back in my name. He said, what land? He said, the land. You told me just leave it. When you pay me the money, you give it back to me. He said, you sold it to me. It's bay' shira. I bought it from you, it says here. He said, go to the court. There are four doors, and inside there are seven courts. There are seven judges. If any one of those judges say that I owe you anything, من عيني هيدي أبل عيني هيدي. I'm ready to give you whatever you want. The man was so hurt, because he can't do anything. He sold it to him legally. It says it's his. But he trusted him. The man got, and he's older, and that piece of land is for the children and the grandchildren. So he was really hurt at this age. How does his grandkids look at him? He's been cheated and lied to. So he was very hurt to the level he got really sick, and he was on his deathbed. And this is how much it affected him. And a brother like this, they prayed together. He was shocked. So he called his older brother, his older son. He said, listen, I'm not gonna make it. When you're taking my janazah to pray in the masjid, that masjid that everybody prays to, prays in, make sure you pass by this man's shop. And you stop the janazah over there, and you give this letter to the man, and you tell him to read it while he's looking at my chest, at the tabut, at the cast. The man died, they took the janazah, the older son stopped the janazah right in front of the man's shop. He went inside, السلام عليكم. عليكم السلام. أطلع uncle, this is a letter from my father. He said, where's your father? He said, he's inside that cast over that casket over there. He said, he will not move until you finish reading the letter. So the man opened the letter. Bismillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. When I asked you for my piece of land, you told me, go to the courthouse. There are four doors and seven courts inside. And if they give it you, if any judge rules your, in your favor, I will give it to you. He said, now I'm going to the court of Allah, where the judge is Allah. If you cannot follow me, do your best not to do that. I will see you there. The man saw this letter, start trembling. He said, the son, come. Opened the drawer, took the deed, and he gave it to the son, and he said, the land is yours. Cheating will never work, ya akhwan. Cheating will never work. Sooner or later, it will come back and haunt you. You will, for a maybe very short period of time, feel that you have maybe achieved something, but wallahi, subhanallah, you will pay for it in the dunya and in the akhirah. There are certain sins that Allah will rush the iqab in the dunya before the akhirah. There are some sins you will only be punished for the akhirah, but there are sins that you will be punished here in the dunya and in the akhirah. One of them is al-baghi, which is one of these things when you take over things that don't belong to you. And second is qat' al-rahm, when you cut your relationship with your family members. These are two things that you will be punished here, according to the hadith, before you are punished in the akhirah. And keep in mind that, subhanallah, like the hadith of Thawban, radiyallahu anhu wa arda, yu'ta yawm al-qiyama bi'unas ma'ahum min al-hasanat ka'amthali jibali tihama. The people would come on the day of judgment with mountains of hasanat. But they cheated this one, and they lied to this one, and they backbite this one. So all we are doing when we are cheating, we are giving on a golden platter our hasanat to that other person. Just like when we backbite somebody. You're giving them your hasanat without any effort from them. Look at Ibn Sirin, rahimahullah. Look how much they used to fear cheating. He used to be in the oil business, olive oil business. One time, he saw from his warehouse a mouse coming drenched in oil. So he figured that this mouse came from one of these barrels. He has 50, 60 barrels of oil, all his fortune. He dumped them all. And he stayed 40 years in debt in order not to cheat anybody, because he does not know which barrel did the mouse come from. Ikhwan, that's why we are discussing and we are talking about these people 1,000 years after they're passed away, because of these actions. But if someone cheat and lie and subhanallah, oppress people, you will never hear about them anymore. But these people, look at these amal, simple amal, that will made them, you know, khalideen in there, even though they are dead. There are some people that they are dead, but they are alive. And there are some people who are alive, but they are dead. هناك بعض الناس هم أحياء لكن موتى وهناك بعض الموتى هم أحياء بفضل أعمالهم. سبحان الله. So نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يحسن خاتمتنا، ونسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يوفقنا لما يحبه ويرضاه. إخوان غدا tomorrow is the Jumu'ah, and as usual every Thursday night I remind you that tomorrow is the best day. The next Salat is the best Salat in the sight of Allah. So please come tomorrow to Fajr and pray your Fajr in Jama'ah and be under the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fajr is at 6:15. I will be giving the first khutbah inshallah. Barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.